Hello, my name is Dr. James Lingeman, and I am a urologist at Indiana University Health. I'm here to explain surgical options for the treatment of kidney stones. 1 in 10 adults will have a kidney stone at some point in their life. Once you have a kidney stone, your chance of having another within 5 years rises to as much as 50%. Some kidney stones within the body are small enough to pass without treatment, but others get caught in the duct or ureter tube that runs from the kidney to the bladder. Left untreated, they can cause severe pain and damage to the kidneys. At IU Health, we use 3 procedures to remove kidney stones and prevent them from returning. Your recommended treatment will be based on the size, location, and hardness of the stone, as well as other factors such as your individual anatomy. Our least invasive procedure is extracorporeal, meaning outside the body, shockwave lithotripsy. It uses high energy shockwaves to disintegrate stones into smaller pieces, which then pass naturally through the body. Shockwave lithotripsy works best for smaller, softer stones, but there is no guarantee that the particles will pass after treatment. Your surgeon cannot interact directly with the stone when this procedure is used, which means that it is only useful for some patients. Another minimally invasive option, flexible ureteroscopy, allows better access to the stone. This technique does not require an incision. Your surgeon inserts a small telescope through the bladder's opening, running up into the affected kidney. Through this telescope, your surgeon can see, break, and remove the stones. Many patients like the idea of this minimally invasive option, but it is not for everyone. Flexible ureteroscopy gives your surgeon limited ability to break up large, numerous, or complex stones. A complex stone is one that is very hard or is located in a hard-to-reach place inside the kidneys. For the right patient, flexible ureteroscopy can be a very effective approach. IU Health Methodist Hospital is a worldwide leader in the next procedure, percutaneous nephrolithotomy, or PCNL, which is recommended for large, numerous, or complex kidney stones. We perform over 300 of these advanced procedures each year. While it is still considered a minimally invasive treatment, PCNL does require a 1/4-inch incision in your back to give the surgeon maximum access to your kidney stones. If you are a candidate for PCNL, you are usually placed on an antibiotic a few days before the surgery to minimize the likelihood of infection caused by bacteria released from the stone during the procedure. After you check in the day of your surgery, you will share your medical history in the pre-op area. There, the nurses will insert an IV to administer fluids, antibiotics, and other medications. Afterwards, you will be moved to the operating room and given a general anesthetic through an IV. Once you are sleeping, we will do 3 things to prepare you for surgery. First, we place a breathing tube down your airway, we insert a catheter into your bladder, and we reposition your body face down for the surgery. The procedure can be done on one or both sides of your back, depending upon your diagnosis. 1 keyhole-sized incision, or occasionally more than one, is made in your back. We then insert a needle into the kidney and stretch a thumb-sized hole that runs from the skin to the kidney. A sheath goes inside this path to hold it open. You can think of the sheath as a thin tube that allows us to insert instruments and remove stone fragments. We search for kidney stones using a lighted telescope to explore the inside of your kidney. When we find stones, we use several devices to fragment, flush, and remove them from the kidneys. Afterwards, we give your kidneys a thorough inspection, searching for small fragments that may have slipped away. It is important to find each and every stone fragment, because anything that remains could cause new stones to grow more rapidly. Once we are confident all stones and fragments are removed, we finish by leaving 2 tubes inside. The first is a thin drainage tube that allows the tract to heal. It sits in the kidney and protects against potential swelling that can block the flow of urine to the bladder. It will be connected to a temporary drainage bag that is usually left in place for 24 to 48 hours after the procedure. The second is a skinny tube that runs from the skin through the kidney and down the ureter. This tube acts as a safety device that can help speed up a second procedure should one be necessary. Both tubes will exit the skin through the same incision. The incision is small enough that it does not require stitches. It will be numbed with medication before we leave the operating room. Finally, we place a dressing over the wound and the tubes. The entire procedure lasts between 90 minutes and 3 hours, depending upon the size and complexity of your stone. After you awake from anesthesia, we take you to your hospital room where you are monitored for 24 hours. The next morning, we take a computed tomography or CAT scan of the kidneys to make sure that no fragments have escaped our initial inspection. If the scan confirms this and there are no other complications, we then take an x-ray using special dye. This is done to confirm normal drainage from the kidneys through to the bladder. If so, all tubes are removed, your wound is bandaged, and you will go home that day. If we find evidence of stone fragments remaining, we will plan to repeat the procedure using the tubes left inside the first time. The remnant stone and tubes are removed in this second procedure, usually within 48 hours of the first surgery. After you go home, you will have some soreness, but you will usually feel better within a week. If you have additional questions, you can contact a member of our expert staff. Or, to learn more, visit iuhealth.org/kidneystones. Thank you for considering IU Health as your partner for care and treatment of kidney stones.